Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of What Your Mother Couldn't Tell You and Your Father Didn't Know. Advanced Relationship Skills for Better Communication and Lasting Intimacy by John Gray. Narrated by George Guidall. This work, copyrighted 1994 by J.G. Productions Incorporated, is recorded by arrangement with HarperCollins Publishers, Incorporated. This recording is copyrighted 1995 by Recorded Books, Incorporated. Times have changed. The old ways of relating, which may have worked for our parents, are definitely out of date and sometimes counterproductive. Relationships today require new skills to achieve lasting fulfillment. Having a husband who brings home a paycheck or a wife who maintains a nice, clean home is no longer enough. And now, What Your Mother Couldn't Tell You and Your Father Didn't Know.
Away from home for the weekend, I was getting ready for bed when someone knocked on my hotel door. It was a participant in the seminar I was teaching. I had noticed her many times during my presentation and found her very attractive. There was strong physical chemistry. As she silently entered the room, she looked straight into my eyes and, without saying a word, unzipped her skirt and let it drop to the floor. My jaw dropped along with it. "I want you," she whispered. My mind went blank. I didn't know what to say. My body rejoiced, but my mind began to panic. After all, I was happily married, and I dearly loved my wife. My uninvited guest continued to undress, and while my mind was trying to get a grip on the situation, every cell in my body was saying yes. Still, I somehow managed to stand my ground and hold back. Without missing a beat, she moved toward me and began to unbutton my shirt. Time seemed to stand still, and nothing existed except the explosive passion of the moment. At the first physical contact, I felt an electric shock shoot through my entire body. In the next moment, I remembered my wife and pulled back. I said, "Excuse me, but I am married. I can't do this." As if the scene had been perfectly choreographed, she confidently responded, "It's okay, I'll never tell." I politely explained, "My wife has little antennas. She knows everything, and this would only hurt her and our relationship. I think you'd better go." She just smiled and said, "But don't you want me to stay?" Although I was a believer in monogamy, I found myself suddenly beginning to reconsider. My mind flooded with rationalizations. How, for instance, could something that felt so good be bad? Why couldn't I be a loving husband at home and also have a little extra pleasure on the side? Finally, after much discussion and emotional struggle, I asked her to leave. I was able to restrain myself because I knew having an affair would hurt my wife. Although I felt I had done the right thing, I couldn't sleep. For hours, my thoughts continued to churn. I had resisted temptation, but my mind began to question if monogamy was really necessary. I couldn't understand why having sex with a willing partner was wrong. I thought maybe monogamy was an outdated tradition and should be overcome. After all, a loving marriage shouldn't be a prison. People should be free to do what they want. Why couldn't I do what my body wanted to do? On the other hand, I certainly didn't want to do anything that would hurt my wife. I myself had been betrayed in a past relationship, and I knew how it felt. The last thing in the world I wanted was to cause her pain, and I certainly wouldn't want her to betray me. Maybe monogamy really was important, and I just didn't understand why. Tossing and turning in bed, I considered the pros and cons of having an affair. My body was saying, do it. My heart was saying, don't do it. And my mind was trying to figure out a way for both to be happy. Before falling asleep, I finally concluded that if I could assure Bonnie of my undying love for her, then maybe it wouldn't hurt her if I had occasional discreet affairs. I reasoned that as long as the affairs were brief and recreational, then possibly there would be no negative emotional repercussions. Thinking this was a good solution, I decided to share with her my new ideas when I returned home. I was excited to see Bonnie, and almost immediately we enjoyed great, passionate, loving sex. Afterward, I told her the story of what had happened on my trip. She was crushed. She asked, "Do you love the woman?" I explained that my attraction to this one was only physical. Feeling completely rejected, she asked me if I still loved her. I tenderly said that I loved her more than anyone in my life. She asked what the other woman looked like and who she was. I answered all her questions, assuring her that we had done no more than talk. Taking Bonnie gently in my arms, I apologized for hurting her. After some time, I proceeded to share with her my new thoughts and feelings about monogamy. Although I was hoping she wouldn't mind if I had discreet little affairs, her response not only changed my mind, but it changed my life forever. I began this memorable conversation by saying, "I didn't do anything with this woman because I would never want to betray you. But I would also very much like to have your permission to have an affair. It doesn't mean I don't love you. It would just be for fun, and I promise to be very discreet and do it only when I'm out of town." Before I could finish, Bonnie began to weep. But distressed as she was, she spoke to me with astonishing strength and clarity. I will always remember her words because they affected me so deeply. She said, "John, I would never want to tell you what you can do. You don't need me to be your mother, nor do I want to be. All I can tell you is my experience. I'm already trying so hard to be open and give you the trust you deserve. I don't want to give up on loving you. I want to grow in love and trust for you." With tears running down her cheeks, she continued, "I have been left before. If I thought you were possibly having affairs when you left to teach your seminars, I would begin to close up. I would always be comparing myself and trying to measure up. I would never feel good enough." Then, after a long pause, she said, "I don't know whether it's right or wrong. All I know is that it would be too difficult for me to stay open." In that instant, my mind became crystal clear. My rationalizations melted away, and my heart was filled with an even deeper, more committed love for my wife. I was so grateful that Bonnie could share her feelings with me in such a magnificent way. I was able to listen without becoming defensive. There was no criticism, blame, or judgment in her words. I felt no need to justify myself. I was able to hear her legitimate need, think about her words, and respond freely. In that moment, I knew that Bonnie loved me and truly wanted me to be happy. I also knew that regardless of whether an affair was morally right or wrong, she needed monogamy as a requirement for growing in love. She needed to feel special in order to love me in an open, receptive, and responsive way, and that specialness was based on the security of monogamy. Like many men and some women, I had imagined that having an occasional fling would make no major impact on my marriage. I was wrong. I hadn't appreciated the sacredness of sex, or that monogamy, and not just love, is the cornerstone of lasting happiness, passion, and intimacy. If Bonnie and I had not shared our feelings that night, I would never have understood that. And why should I have been expected to understand in the first place? My father didn't understand any more than his father did. And my mother would never have felt entitled to tell him about her need to feel special, certainly not with the strength and clarity Bonnie exhibited. My mother's attitudes were forged in another time, and her strength was of a different kind. In the 50s, when I was growing up, my father secretly confessed to my mother that he was having an affair. What had probably started out as a moment of passion gradually became more serious, and he asked my mother for a divorce. My mother loved my father and was deeply hurt. Instead of sharing her tender feelings and thereby showing him how much she loved and needed him, she became strong and in the most loving way she knew said, "If that's what you want, then I will give you a divorce. Let's think about it for a month and then you decide." Fate intervened when, a week later, my mother discovered that she was pregnant with their seventh child. With this new responsibility, my father decided not to leave her and the family. My mother was very happy, and nothing more was said about his other interests. For several years, he continued to have affairs in other cities, but they never talked about it. Though they never divorced, this was a major turning point in their relationship. They continued to love and support each other as husband and wife, but something was missing. The loving romance and playfulness of love slowly began to disappear. When I became an adult, I eventually heard the rumors of my dad's affairs and asked him about it. His response was, "What you don't know can't hurt you." As I persisted in asking more questions, that's all he would tell me. I realized that this was the way he had justified his affairs. He didn't want to hurt my mother and had rationalized that if he was discreet, she wouldn't be hurt. To some extent, he was right. My mother seemed to be okay with his affairs and never broached the subject or asked him to stop. What neither of them knew was that without monogamy, they would eventually snuff out the delicate and tender feelings of affection that attracted them to each other. Like many couples, they mistakenly assumed that it was natural to lose physical attraction and passion after years of marriage. After my father's death, Mom and I came across a snapshot of him with one of his mistresses. When my mother saw it, tears came to her eyes, tears that were not shed when he was alive. I knew why she was crying. I could feel her pain at seeing him so open and free with another woman, seeing in his eyes the sparkle they had once shared but which had gradually disappeared from their relationship. I also felt the personal pain of never having seen my dad so happy. He'd been a loving father, but often moody, angry, or depressed. In this picture, in his secret world, he was charming, helpful, and happy. This was the father I'd longed to know and be like. When I asked my mother why she thought he had felt the need to stray, she answered, "Your father and I loved each other very much, but as the years passed, I became a mother, and your father wanted a wife." I was amazed by how she was so accepting of his infidelity. She told me, "I admired your father for staying. It was a great sacrifice on his part. He had strong desires, but he didn't desert us." On that day, I could finally understand why he had betrayed her. He had stopped being romantically attracted to her and just didn't know what to do about it. He didn't know how to share the responsibilities of a family and also be romantic. He didn't know how to bring back the passion and joy in their relationship. If he had known, he wouldn't have given up and strayed. I also realized that my mother had done the best she could. She knew too well how to be a loving mother, but was not adept at the art of keeping romance alive. She was following in the footsteps of her mother and her mother's mother. It was, after all, a different world then, with different rules. In the days of my mother's youth, with the Depression followed by World War II, Survival was more important than romantic and emotional needs. People just didn't reveal their inner...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.